Hello and welcome to Newsclick. Today we are joined by Prabir Purkayastha to discuss the recent developments in the COVID-19 pandemic. So Prabir, we know that this disease, this virus is only continuing to spread across the world. There are already over 190,000 cases and there are very few countries which are now left unaffected. So can we first start by focusing on Europe, which has become the new center of this pandemic? Can you tell us how Italy and other countries, Italy which is now the second worst affected, or I think it has more cases and more active cases than China, how Italy and how the other countries in Europe are coping with this?
Well, coping or not coping with it, because it does seem that the hospitals are in a state of partial collapse, particularly northern Italy, the Lombardy region, which has been the most affected. It has also happened because the number of people who are coming to the hospitals are much larger than the hospital infrastructure. This is partly because Italy has an older population, and that it does show that the COVID-19 epidemic affects older people much more than the younger people. If we take the mortality rates, we will see that for the 0 to 9, virtually no mortality. If we come between, say, 10 to 19 or even 10 to 40, again, the mortality rate is only 0.2%, the case fatality ratio. If you go to 40 to 50, it rises to 0.4%. These are Chinese figures. And then if you go over the next deciles, this 50, 60, 70s and 80s, there's a disproportionate rise. And above 80, you get figures of something like 18%. Now that's a very, very high figure. So the kind of people, the demography of the people who are infected also tells us the nature of the fatalities. And as you can see, the number of people dying in Italy is very high. So that's perhaps one of the things that we need to take away from this. I'll come to why the infection spread the way it did just a little later. But right now, looking at the crisis of the hospital systems, there is also the issue, did the actually infection spread in the hospitals itself? Because as the people came in, that how the infections were controlled, how prepared were the hospitals for that? All of this has been raised as a question. But it is also true that the older people, what you are getting is also bacterial infection. So most of the patients have not only the viral infection, but also what would be called the co-bacterial infection. And that's making the cases much more difficult to handle. Coming back to why is it that Italy faced this kind of epidemic? And it's really Italy, which was the first one to exhibit this runaway epidemic, so to say, in Italy, in Europe. And it is now being followed by Spain, it's being followed by France, it's followed by Germany. Yeah. Spain seems to be the next one which is following Italy, not very far, and then France and Germany. So why did this happen in Italy? Now, it's again, the issue is that when you start testing, initially, when you have what is called the containment phase, at that stage, the argument is that you have to test the incoming people who are coming, who have the infection, and their contacts. A lot of the people who seem to have come with infection did not exhibit any symptoms. That is why testing at the airports is not enough. You need to really follow up the testing. And then you can silently, as it were, spread the infection amongst the community. Once it becomes a community spread, the containment phase is over. And if you do not recognize through enough testing or enough checking up, follow-ups of the people who have come in from outside, when they're likely to get in, whether they're likely to show symptoms, all of that, if you don't do that follow-up closely, then what can happen is there is a silent community spread which you're not catching. This is what seemed to have happened in Washington State in the United States, and seems to have happened in the Lombardy region, which is the one most affected, in which Milan is, of course, the key city. Now, given this, what happens is once it's in the community, then lockdowns is only one part, but that's not enough. As Bruce Aylward, who was a part of the WHO's, he co-headed the team, WHO's team to China, in which there were Chinese WHO and a joint team to look at all the lessons. As he says very clearly, that this is only the first step, the lockdowns. That's not what stops the disease. After that, what the Chinese did was to find out very quickly by setting up fever clinics. Anybody who was felt he had a fever, could be a possible case, was sent to fever clinics. They were tested there, they waited there, and if they were found positive, the test had to be completed within a certain period of time in which they actually stayed in the fever clinic at a suitable social distance from other such people who were being tested. And this then, those who were found to be infected were transferred in the first instance to larger facilities, which could be gymnasiums, could be stadiums, could be warehouses, where large numbers of people were there with what would be the first phase or the mild phase of the disease. And the minute they were serious, they were transferred to the hospitals. So they isolated the people who could be infected from even the family members, because otherwise you get family transmission. So young kid is infected, he doesn't feel any effect, but the grandma, the grandpa then are also infected. So that's what they had to stop, and they did that. So as Aylward himself says about Italy, that people reached out to him and said, we have done the lockdown and the quarantines. He said, you have done the hard part, but the really hard part comes now. How to isolate the cases and remove them from the family, from other settings, so that they don't infect others. Otherwise, the family infection also sees a runaway rate of infection. Every person can infect 3-4 others. So you don't really stop the cycle of the infection. So I think this is the takeaway, the lesson that we have to learn from Italy. And all those countries who were saying, oh, it's a Chinese problem, you know, it's only the Chinese authoritarianism, these lockdowns don't work and so on, they really did not do what was required. That understand what the Chinese were doing, build solidarity with the Chinese, learn those lessons. They had this, I will call it the Western underlying racist attitude that all countries, including China, are not developed. They will not be able to cope with this thing. That's natural. But we who are superior, we are the Western world, will actually be much more effective in dealing with it because we have a superior system. Now, it shows that one thing the germs, viruses don't recognize is race, you know, countries and so on. So I think this has been a great leveler. And I think European Union, the countries now are showing what the Chinese did was right. And they didn't learn the lessons that China had actually developed. And it is this lack of learning, the slowness with which they imbibe these lessons, for which they are paying a price today. Unfortunately, it is really not the leadership of the countries, but the people of those countries who will pay this price.
And India, if we talk about India, then Indian authorities are still saying that we are still in the containment phase, although WHO has said that there is local transmission. So why is this contradiction there? Is it because of the very little testing that is being done?
Well, at the moment, from what we see, it could still be we are in the containment phase, that people who are actually getting infected are the people who are either come in from outside with the carrying the virus disease, or those who have come in contact with them. So we are doing extensive contact tracing by all accounts. And if we are able to successfully isolate it after contact tracing, quarantining them, self-isolation, all these measures that we are talking about before there is any infection visible, then it's possible that we will be able to contain it. So at the moment, I would not say that WHO is saying that we should test everybody. WHO has also said that the containment phase, this is what you should do. Either somebody's in contact with somebody who's been infected, known to be infected, or who has come from these countries. So India, I think ICMR has 12 countries it has identified. I think they have increased the number to more countries yesterday or today. So I think we are doing a certain set of steps. If it gets into the population, we are going to have a big crisis on our hands. The only saving grace as of now is those countries which seem to be a little warmer do not seem to show as yet questions on this, because Malaysia is very similar to India climatically, but it is showing some numbers going up. So is the temperature going to stop the rapidity of the infections? That is something we need to watch. Maybe yes, maybe no. Jury is out on that one as yet. But that only will postpone, shall we say, the epidemic, because then it will come back when it is really much colder. So I think at the moment, fingers crossed, India still seems to be in a containment state. It also seems that ICMR's, you know, random testing of others who are infected, have respiratory problems, testing them would or could track some of these cases if they've already got COVID-19. It seems that these test cases that they have done, random sampling of those who are sick with respiratory diseases, haven't shown any COVID-19 cases. So as of now, we could be still in the containment phase, but fingers crossed on that.
What do you feel about UK's herd immunity strategy, which Boris Johnson has sort of the plan they were thinking of taking on protecting the country? Do you think that can actually be effective?
Well, I think they've given it up after about 5 days when a team did a modeling exercise to show if a herd immunity needs to be created, how many people are going to fall sick. Will lead to fall sick, it's 60% of the population, which is 36 million Brits have to fall sick. Mm-hmm. Now, that if you extrapolate means anything between 1 to 5% fatality. As we saw Italy's figures, Wuhan's figures, once you have a very large number of infections, the hospital systems collapse and therefore your fatality rate goes up. So anything between 1 to 5% is possible. Wuhan had something like 4.7 or 5%. Rest of China had less than 1%. So this is what happens when you have a very large number of cases. So if you have 36 million people, it could be anything between, if it is 1%, then it's 360,000. If it is 5%, we are talking about 1.8 million people dying of the disease. I think after these numbers, they have now gone back to what everybody is doing, which is, you know, social distancing and we are starting to see lockdowns. But the point is, as Dr. Aylward has said, this is not enough. That lockdowns will only create a basic environment within which you then have to step in with identifying, testing, and then isolating those who are found infected. So that's where the WHO Director General statement comes, test, test, and test continuously. So that is the issue that UK has to face. And again, how their health services, which has been hollowed out partly by the Tory governments over the last 10 years, how that will shape up to this. This is something that we have to see.
And if we look at the US, not only is it facing a crisis in its own country because of, well, the lack of testing, but also the US is continuing to impose new sanctions on Iran and Venezuela, even after this pandemic, which is making it difficult for these countries to cope with the crisis. So what can you tell us about this situation?
You know, the US seems to have entered into a completely heartless state. There is no human empathy that you see in the Trump administration. They decided that they could keep the disease out. It was a foreign disease. Even now, Trump insists on calling it a Chinese disease. The germs are not Chinese. The viruses are not Chinese. It's now cross borders. So it's now an European disease, if you will. But the belief that foreigners bring disease is something which is fundamental to the Trump psyche. The second problem, of course, why did they not do testing on the scale that is required? Even now, it's much slower than most other countries. Now, was it because they wanted to hide figures or because they had already disempowered the CDC and their epidemic fighting apparatus? That led to this fiasco over testing. We don't know. It's also true that Trump did not want the figures initially to come out because he thought it would affect his re-election. But given the nature of the epidemic, now they are sort of coming out in the open and they cannot deny that they have these figures, that they have to do something about it. So now they're taking the other tack. Private sector will solve our problems. Mm-hmm. Google will solve our problems. Some director, chairman has told me that he has a vaccine which is going to give in 3 months. All of this wishful thinking that capital will solve all the problems of the country. But what you raised is essentially in these conditions, instead of solidarity, what you find is this essentially an extension of the war, extending it even to the issue of fighting the disease. That's why you see sanctions in Iran and Venezuela at this stage. You also see bombing in Iraq. Now, this is taking place. Iraq is supposed to be an ally. You're bombing Iraq. And at the same time, Chinese are sending medical teams to Iraq. Of course, they're also sending to Iran. They're also sending it to Italy. And Jackie Ma, the richest man in China, has also sent masks to the United States. So you have this complete lack of empathy with the world that Trump and his administration seems to show. And I think the most brutal part of this attitude is when you try to buy the German vaccine company, thinking that then you will have a monopoly on this and then you can fleece the rest of the world. These are, you know, something which is so heartless. I cannot understand how the American people can even look at what their government is doing without actually reacting to it. At the moment, the reaction is to Trump, and it is fairly on predictable lines, Republicans versus Democrats. But the larger issue of what the US administration represents, and as you said, under these conditions, not relaxing the sanctions so that these countries cannot get medical equipment quickly, this is completely a continuation of its brutal policies, which they've imposed both on Iran and on Venezuela, which has seen millions of people being affected by various problems, including hunger, you know, disease and so on. So I don't think you are going to see a change in the American attitude. This is simply make America great again at the expense of the rest of the world. That's the policy they seem to be following. And the pandemic makes no difference to them.
Finally, what do you think is going to be the future course of this pandemic? Will we see a fall in numbers anytime soon?
Well, this is the big unknown, that as of now, the global south has been less affected. Now, are we going to see it increase in these countries? If it does, we have an even bigger disaster on our hands, because it's the public health system in these places will not stand up to the kind of epidemic we are seeing in Italy. So then we really are going to see 1918 Spanish flu all over again. I'm hoping it will not happen. Okay, this is a fond hope. We don't know whether it will really transpire or not. So it may be just a fond hope. But at the same time, we still have to prepare to the extent we can. And for all countries like India, we have the double problem. If we do lockdowns at the scale where it is happening in Italy, for example, a very large section of our people depend on their daily earnings. They don't have any cushion. How will they survive? We had demonetization. They survived with difficulty. How will they survive? On top of that, you have the disease. So I think we are in for very hard times if we cannot contain the disease, because the vaccine is the only long-term solution, and that is a good 12 months away still. The only other issue that we seem to, which gives a little bit of hope, is that the hydrochloroquines, basically the anti-malarials, which can be produced very cheaply, generic drugs, they're widely available, they seem to be working also. You see, the anti-AIDS drugs are expensive, which is the ritonavir, lopinavir, this kind of combinations which are being seen. The other thing that Gilead Science is talking about that's even more expensive, you have the biotech from interferon from Cuba, but all of those are going to be more complex. Bulk production is difficult, and they're not small molecules. So therefore, this is an expensive process, even if the patent part is not taken into account. But if you have small molecules, which is what the chloroquines are, then this anti-malarial drugs, then there can be a lot more effective treatment. So we really have to see, are there small molecule drugs which can be produced in bulk to address the disease? At the moment, again, fingers crossed, hope that this works. Let's see whether we get more drugs which can aid us in this.
Thank you, Prabir, for talking to us today. And that's all the time we have in Newsclick today. Keep watching Newsclick.
Thank you.